great pleasure to introduce Nevan Krogan, a professor at the University of California, San Francisco, also director of the Quantitative Biosciences Institute. So I've known Nevan now for something like 13 years, and two things that I can note. One is his jackets have become increasingly more interesting. And secondly, you have to be careful whenever you talk with him because he'll convince you of almost anything. And so I guess he's going to show you something that he's been convincing people to do now more recently, together with several investigators. Go ahead, Nevan.
All right. Thanks, Pedro. I was going to pre-record my talk, but I had to listen to what Pedro was going to say in his introduction. So I'm doing this live. And so I'd like to thank the organizers, Pedro and Nassos, Pascal, Dirk, Thomas, for giving me this opportunity to tell you about some recent work that's been carried out in the context of the QCRG, the QVI Coronavirus Research Group, which is based out of UCSF. And it started initially with 22 different labs at UCSF and has since expanded to over 40 labs encompassing hundreds of different scientists. And these groups have come together in a very integrative and unprecedented way. Systems biologists, structural biologists, chemical biologists, computer scientists, and virologists all coming together, bringing their skill set to the table to try to come up with solutions for this particular pandemic. And I'm going to tell you about two papers that has recently been published from the QCRG. The first is a protein-protein interaction map that was generated to point to drug repurposing. And then the second is a global phosphorylation analysis that was done to identify kinases that were misregulated to ultimately come up with a kinase inhibitor. So the first I'm going to tell you about is the first paper here on the left. And the approach that we're taking in general at QCRG, or one of the approaches anyway, is to try to understand how the virus comes in and hijacks and rewires the host. So there's a lot of effort ongoing, as you heard in the last talk from Susan, of strategies, drugs trying to target the virus, and that's fantastic. We're taking a different tack. We're looking at the host. We're trying to come up with host-directed therapies, and I would argue there's advantages to that, including you don't have to worry so much about resistance, obviously, because we don't mutate as fast as the virus is. And we and others have shown that many different types of viruses come in and hijack and rewire similar machinery in the host during infection. So if you could come up with a strategy for COVID-19, hopefully that could work for COVID-22, COVID-24, and maybe other viral infections. There's disadvantages, obviously. There's toxicity issues if you target the host. But one of our big focuses here is to look initially at FDA-approved drugs or compounds in clinical trials that have already passed toxicity issues. So hopefully toxicity wouldn't be such an issue using this approach. So as you just heard from Susan, there's about 30 genes in SARS-CoV-2 compared to 20,000 genes in each one of our cells. This virus cannot exist by itself. It needs our cells, our genes, our proteins in order to live and replicate and infect our cells. So what we wanted to do was to find all the human proteins that the virus would need to infect our cells. And one approach that we employed was a systematic affinity tag purification mass spec-based approach, which I'll speak a little bit more about in a minute. And doing this, we identified over 300 proteins, and then this allowed us to narrow down to 69 different drugs and compounds that we thought would target at least one of these proteins and that could potentially have an antiviral effect. So this type of approach, protein-protein interaction mapping, looking at different viruses, we've done over the last dozen years or so, including looking at HIV, different enteroviruses, influenza, Ebola. And normally a generation of one of these maps takes at least a year and if not longer. But we generated this particular map in a matter of weeks. And to me, that was a testament to the collaborative spirit that went into this QCRG program, especially before the shutdown was put in place here at UCSF in the middle of March. So Susan did much better than I could do. She summarized the SARS-CoV-2 genome. So in total, we looked at 29. We tried to clone out all of the 29 genes. We got most of them. I think we're one of the first groups to synthesize every single one of them and put affinity tag on them. And what we did here was to express them individually in human cells, lyse the cells, purify each one of the proteins individually using the 2X strep tag. That was our affinity tag. Analyze the material by mass spec, and then apply algorithms that we and others have developed to come up with what we argued was a high confidence quantitative SARS-CoV-2 human protein-protein interaction map. And at the time we initially put this out, we put it on Bar Archive at the end of March, and I just tweeted out from our lab that we've got these constructs. We're happy to send them to whoever would like them. No MTAs. There are no lawyers at work anyway, so it didn't matter. No strings attached. Please feel free to distribute. And in a couple of weeks, we actually sent out this set of genes to over 350 labs in 40 different countries. And I'd like to say that these plasmids went around the world a lot faster than the virus did. And we're very happy to be able to send out these reagents and help facilitate the research that's ongoing with SARS-CoV-2. So hopefully, as a scientific community, we can come up with solutions to it. So here's a look at the original map that we had generated. So as I said, 332 SARS-CoV-2 human protein-protein interactions, including 66 different druggable host proteins corresponding to 69 different drugs or compounds. Obviously, the red diamonds are the viral proteins. The circles here are the human proteins. If it's orange, we think it's a druggable target. And we actually collaborated with a company in Hollywood called Zoic Labs. This is a company that's been involved in making movies such as Titanic and Life of Pi. Biz Stone, the founder of Twitter, and Ron Conway got us connected with this particular company. And they created this very interactive database and website where one can go in a very intuitive way, look at the information that we have generated. So if you're interested in this data, I'd encourage you to look at the paper, look at this website. And what they've told me recently is that there's been thousands of people that have looked at this data from almost 90 different countries. So I think it's a very cool and interactive way to look at our information. So as I said, one of the goals here was to look at the human proteins and then identify drugs and compounds that were known to bind one of these human proteins, so and to see if they had antiviral effects. So in total, we had 69, a mixture of FDA-approved drugs, compounds in clinical trials, and preclinical compounds as well. Here's remdesivir, which Susan told you about, targeting NSP12. The question is, are any of these other drugs, do they have any effects as antivirals? And this work has been spearheaded by Brian Schoiket and Kevan Shokat, two fantastic chemical biologists here at UCSF. So we wanted to test these drugs and compounds, but we didn't have the virus propagating at the time. And so we reached out to some close collaborators to test these drugs and compounds who did have the virus propagating in a laboratory setting, including scientists at the Pasteur Institute, especially Marco Vignuzzi, Olivia Schwartz, and Christoph Danfer, and then a good friend of mine, Adolfo Garcia Sastra, at the Department of Microbiology at Mount Sinai Hospital. So they had two slightly different assays working in the lab, complementary, and it was great that we had two collaborators in two labs in two continents, because if we got the same results, this would give us more confidence that we're identifying physiologically relevant data. So we're looking initially at VIRO6 cells, African green monkey cells, growing them up 2 hours before infection, adding a drug, infecting here at two different MOIs, four times higher in Paris, as you can see, letting the assay go for 2 days, and then killing it with formaldehyde. In New York, they were doing a microscopy-based assay looking at an antibody for NP, as well as in certain cases, TCID50. In Paris, they were looking at the RNA component of the virus, doing QRT-PCR, and then plaque assays. So it was great to have these two fantastic set of virologists in two different continents carrying out these assays for us. So in total, we looked at almost two-thirds of the drugs and compounds that we had predicted that could have an effect. And this is what we initially published. We have actually now screened the remaining third, and we have some interesting hits there, but I'm just going to focus on the drugs and compounds that looked interesting in this first two-thirds. And approximately 10 agents showed potent antiviral effects in the laboratory setting. The first here are some drugs and compounds targeting protein translation, including zotadifin. This is presently in a clinical trial for multiple myeloma. It's from the company Effector. It's founded by a couple of different UCSF scientists, Kevan Shokat and Davide Ruggiero. So zotadifin is known to bind and inhibit EIF4A. It's a translational initiation protein. We actually found its binding partner, EIF4H, in our protein-protein interaction map, binding to NSP9. That was our connection. And ternatinin-4 was another compound. This was synthesized by Jack Taunton here. It's known to bind to EIF1A. It's a translational elongation factor. And interestingly here, there's another drug called pladepsin. It's also called aplidine. It's from a company in Spain. This is a drug that's been approved there actually to treat multiple myeloma. And this is actually presently in a clinical trial for COVID-19. There's some very exciting results coming from this. And with zotadifin, we're working with Effector to get this into a clinical trial right now. So the other set of drugs and compounds that we're very excited about are ones that are thought to or known to modulate these two receptors, which we think are key for the virus to infect our cells, sigma R1 and sigma R2. The drugs include antihistamines, antipsychotics, antimalarial drugs. Here's our friend hydroxychloroquine, the female hormone progesterone, anti-anxiety medications, and some very exciting preclinical compounds as well. And if you were just to look at all the chemical compounds here, their structures listed here, there's no way you could group these together. But if you knew what the target was, and we think we do, this is how you group them together. And this is why what we're doing is different than what a lot of other groups are doing. We're doing data-driven drug discovery or data-driven drug repurposing. So we're letting the biology point us in the right direction with respect to which drugs and compounds we're looking at. Then if you get a hit, you can go back to the biology and go back and forth between the biology and the pharmacology to go 50 steps forward, hopefully, to find something that could be useful. So we're very excited about these two groups. And at the present time, we're finding the best in class of the sigma R1, R2 modulators to ultimately take into a clinical trial. So for the last few minutes of my talk, I'll talk to you about the second paper that was done, another great collaboration. It was worked closely with Pedro Beltreo and a number of scientists at EMBL EBI. And what we did here was we wanted to globally look at the phosphorylation changes in the context of infection to identify kinases, to ultimately identify kinase inhibitors. And this was work done at the Pasteur Institute initially, where they infected Vero E6 cells with SARS-CoV-2. And in a time-dependent manner, 2, 4, 8, 12, and 24 hours post-infection, we're globally looking at the phosphorylation changes. There's a lot of interesting biology in this data set. So Pedro and his team simply just clustered this data initially into these five different groups. And you can see sets of proteins being hyperphosphorylated, hypophosphorylated, phosphorylation that goes up or down and then down then up. So there's a ton of great biology in here. But one of the things they really wanted to do was to identify the kinases that were most misregulated based on the phosphorylation patterns. And Pedro's done some amazing work on this front, developing computational tools so people can do this very robustly. And we identified a set of kinases that were both upregulated here in red and downregulated as well in the context of infection. So then what we can do is go to Kayvon Shokat, just down the hall. He's got one of the best freezers for kinase inhibitors. He's one of the best in the world, obviously, at pharmacologically inhibiting kinases. So we looked at the kinases that Pedro identified. Then we looked at kinase inhibitors, and we started to screen these to see which ones had antiviral effects. One that was had an antiviral effect was a drug against casein kinase 2. You can see over here that Pedro predicted that casein kinase 2 is actually most upregulated in infected cells. Interestingly, we actually found casein kinase 2 physically interacting with N protein in our protein-protein interaction map. I'm going to come back to that in just a minute. We also found CDK inhibitors having potent antiviral effects, PI5 kinases as well. We're very excited about this drug. And there was another set of kinases that we found to be upregulated, these MAP kinase cascades that were involved in the P38 pathway. And there's a couple of drugs here that look very potent. Actually, some of these are more potent than remdesivir in a laboratory setting. And we also genetically confirmed this pathway is important for infection. We did RNAi knockdowns of a number of the MAP kinases and showed that you do see decreased infection as well. And this is such a great pathway because there's a lot of drugs that are known to inhibit different kinases in this pathway. And we're now screening through these and trying to find what would be the best one to ultimately take forward. So I just want to end by talking a little bit more about the connection between the N protein and casein kinase 2. We wanted to look at this in a little bit more detail. And Pedro reached out to Robert Gross at the University of Freiburg in Germany to do some co-localization experiments for us. And he got very excited when he started to look at the infected cells. He reported here that actually in infected cells, you start to see this formation of this filopodia, these actin-based structures. And these filopodia are actually been formed with other viruses, including smallpox. But to my knowledge, it hasn't been to this extent of the filopodia formation, and it's very rare to see this branching. And the idea here is that these are tubes, filopodia, that poke holes in other cells, and it's a way for the virus to tunnel through these tubes so that they can infect other cells in a more efficient way in an ACE2-independent manner. And actually, when he looked at the co-localization, you could actually see casein kinase 2 and the N protein co-localizing actually in this filopodia. We then reached out to Elizabeth Fisher at Rocky Mountain Labs in Montana. She did some beautiful EM imaging for us. Here's a cross section. You can see the filopodia. You can see the virus budding off the tip of the filopodia. She generated some other very cool images as well. The spaghetti in red here is the filopodia, and then the viral particles are in yellow that are budding off of the filopodia. So our model here is, with respect to this filopodia formation, is that we think the N protein is hijacking casein kinase 2, manipulating downstream phosphorylated targets in a way that's reorganizing the cytoskeleton so the virus can induce the formation of this filopodia. Interestingly here, we actually found some downregulation phosphorylation-wise of a pathway connected to Rho. And we have found that actually NSP7 is physically associated with Rho. So this is our working model of how the virus is manipulating these kinase cascades to reorganize the cytoskeleton to generate this filopodia to potentially be more infectious. And I'll just end here by showing you this one really cool picture that Elizabeth generated for us. It actually really looks like these tentacles. It's like some sort of horror movie here. And the blue here is the viral particles. And I think these images are so cool because they don't just look great. They're actually biologically revealing as well. So we're really excited about a number of drugs. This was a set that was published in the San Francisco Chronicle a couple of days ago. We've narrowed in on about 10. There's actually three of these that are already in clinical trials, and we're monitoring them closely. And then we're partnering with other entities to get some of these ones that aren't in clinical trials into clinical trials, including this one that we're very excited about, zotadifin. And so future work, obviously, we're transitioning these into clinical trials. We're doing a lot of work with respect to combinatorial studies with these drugs, including with remdesivir. I personally think you're going to need a cocktail approach, just like we had for HIV. So maybe you need remdesivir with one of these host factor drugs or two of these host factor drugs. We're doing a lot of genetic studies now with CRISPR and RNAi to genetically validate the proteins were identified in the proteomic studies. And we've just recently now finished a generation of a protein-protein interaction map with SARS-CoV-1 and MERS. We're doing a three-way comparison between SARS-CoV-2, SARS-CoV-1, and MERS, and we'll have OC43 very quickly as well. So that's very exciting from an evolutionary point of view to compare these maps. So obviously we had a lot of great collaborators for this work. I alluded to some of the academic relationships. There's many, many more, and a lot of industry connections as well. And that just allows me to segue, I think, to the last slide here and to make the point that it's been obviously a tragedy, this pandemic, but the silver lining for me was to see how fast we can move when we all work together. I have big problems with science because it's so siloed, and oftentimes collaboration is discouraged. But in this case, you can see that silos are broken down across different laboratories, across different institutions, between academics and pharmaceutical companies, and you can see how fast we can move. And the challenge, I think, for us as scientists is to keep this infrastructure in place, keep this spirit in place when the dust settles on COVID-19, so we're more prepared for the next pandemic, be it COVID-22, COVID-24, some other virus, or why aren't we just working on all diseases like this? Why aren't we working on breast cancer and Alzheimer's and Parkinson's? So I hope we can keep this spirit in place going forward. So I acknowledged the people that we've been working with, and this is just a picture of my lab taken, I think, a month before the pandemic. It feels like 10 years ago now. Just to highlight a couple people here, David Gordon and Gwendolyn Zhang led our protein-protein interaction work. Medi spearheaded, along closely with Pedro, the post-translational modification analysis. And then I also want to acknowledge Danielle, Sweeney, Ruth Huttenhain, and Robin Cake. These are fantastic scientists that lead the mass spec facility associated with my lab. These are all great scientists, and it's been a pleasure working with them and all our collaborators, and I appreciate your attention. I'll be happy to take questions now.
Thank you, Nevan. Thank you. That's fantastic. So we have time for questions. We have several here. Probably not be able to go through all of them, but I'll start just reading out a few. So one from Pablo Porras, he's asking, could you comment on the comparison between this interaction map and the two other ones that have been made available as preprints?
Yeah, Matthias Mann and colleagues have carried out a protein-protein interaction study for SARS-CoV-2, and I think in SARS-CoV-1 as well. We're looking closely at those data right now. There is overlap and there's some differences and as well. And he's also got a phosphorylation data set in that particular paper. And I know Pedro's looking closely at that data as well. So that work is ongoing. And I think it's great. Multiple groups are doing this and putting all the information together to get a more complete picture will hopefully lead to better therapeutic avenues in the future.
So a question from Yovi Santama. Congratulations, Dr. Krogan. How were you able to do this work so quickly? Do people not sleep, or is there a huge team effort and collaboration of teams?
Well, I'm here at 1 a.m, so my whole lab's functioning right now. But no, it was, I mean, what I would say is, at least my group, we've been creating this technology and focusing it on a number of other viruses over the last 10, 12 years. I alluded to a little bit of that at the beginning of my talk. So we kind of honed our skills on HIV, on influenza, on Ebola, and we were really in a perfect position then to pivot when this virus came on board to do this type of experimental and computational analysis. But also being said, we have a very collaborative lab. Everybody really just dropped what they were doing. I have 30 scientists in my group. Basically, we're just working on this full time. And then you see all the great collaborators around the world as well that we're working with, including you, Pedro. So it was just, it was a combination of just being at the right place at the right time with respect to the technology, and then having all these great collaborators coming on board and really moving things along quickly.
Yeah, Jonathan Rothblatt asks, how effective are the inhibitory drugs identified in the host proteins and kinase screens in virus cells in blocking replication in relevant tissues, cell types, and animal models?
Yeah, so all of the drugs that I alluded to there in VIRO6 cells, are the antiviral effects are recapitulated in A549 cells expressing ACE2. And we're also doing this in CACO2 cells as well. So it looks like all, you know, I know we're looking at African green monkey cells initially, but it looks like it's being recapitulated in the human cells. Work is now ongoing in collaboration with Adolfo Garcia Sastra with all of the ones that I've highlighted, putting them into hamster models and mouse models too, but hamster to start with. So we're doing that. And as I said, there's a number of these already gone into humans, and most of these are FDA approved drugs or compounds that are in clinical trials that have passed toxicity. So obviously the bar has now been lowered and to try to get some of these drugs into people, and we're looking how best and most ethically to do that.
Okay, I think we're essentially out of time. There are still multiple unanswered questions if you happen to have time and want to type them in. That would be fantastic. If not, you can. It's very late there.
No, I'll do that. I'll do that right now. Thank you.
I think we can move on. Thank you for taking it very much.